We are going to present a case of this a lady who came in with severe pulmonary valve stenosis and a pulmonary valvotomy for that. She's a 25-year-old lady who is a recent immigrant to the US from Somalia, presented with worsening dyspnea on exertion for the past many years, and now her exercise tolerance was limited to only 10 minutes. On examination, there was a palpable thrill in the left subclavian area, loud systolic murmur heard loudest in the pulmonary area. As a result of which, we did an echocardiogram, which showed a normal LV function, moderate RV dilatation, RV hypertrophy, RV function was mildly reduced, mild tricuspid regurgitation, and severe pulmonary valve stenosis with a peak gradient of 87 millimeters of mercury across the valve and a mean gradient of 45 millimeters of mercury. This is the echocardiogram, which demonstrates the severe pulmonary stenosis. We did a cardiac MRI, and as you can appreciate on the cardiac MRI, there is a right ventricular hypertrophy as well as the pulmonary valve, and you can see the jet of flow going through the pulmonary valve right here. And that demonstrates the pulmonary valve stenosis as well as there was dilatation of the mean pulmonary. So we took her to the cardiac catheterization laboratory and obtained gradients across the pulmonary valve, and here you can see a significant gradient across the pulmonary valve was obtained. So to do the pulmonary valvuloplasty, what we did was initially you do a RV gram, and that again demonstrates the right ventricular hypertrophy. You can see the pulmonary valve as well as dilatation of the main pulmonary artery. After that, we used a balloon-tipped catheter to cross the pulmonary valve. The reason to use the balloon-tipped catheter is to make sure that you are not going through the tricuspid apparatus while you are while going through this. And I used a balloon wedge catheter in this case, which has a 0.35 lumen. We exchanged it for a stiff amplex wire, and that wire was placed in one of the branches of the pulmonary artery. After that, you can see also there's a pacemaker placed in the RV, and that is for rapid pacing during the pulmonary valvotomy. Again, an RV gram was placed once the 20 millimeter Z-med balloon was placed across this annulus to make sure that we are in the right position. And the next image shows going up with the balloon, and you can see that nice, how in the center you can see that nice valvotomy happening of the pulmonary valve, and with the rapid pacing we were able to prevent any watermelon seeding and injury to the pulmonary artery with this. After the valvotomy, we did two of these, and after the valvotomy, her gradient dropped from 87 of peak to 37, and a mean gradient dropped to 28 millimeters of mercury. An RV gram was obtained after this. Now, if we talk about pulmonary valve stenosis, generally the pulmonary valve is a tricuspid valve, and you can see there are two kinds of pulmonary, two reasons for pulmonary valve stenosis. One is the commissural fusion, which you can see in the center panel, and that is generally, you see a dome-shaped structure, and the other reason is, which is seen in about 10 to 20% of the cases, the dysplastic pulmonary valve. And the reason it's important to acknowledge this and know what kind of valve is causing the pulmonary stenosis, because the size of your balloon will be determined by the kind of anatomy. The physiological impact of pulmonary stenosis is that there is increased right ventricular afterload, leading to right ventricular hypertension and hypertrophy, and hypertrophy of the infundibular outflow tract, leading to dynamic RV obstruction, tricuspid regurgitation, and finally RV dilatation and right heart failure. Grades of pulmonary valve stenosis, less than 40 millimeters is mild, moderate is 40 to 60, and severe is greater than 60. Indications are in asymptomatic patients with a peak gradient greater than 60 or a mean gradient more than 40 is when you consider pulmonary valvotomy, and in symptomatic patients, a peak gradient greater than 50 or a mean gradient greater than 30 millimeters of mercury. How do you do your balloon sizing? You can look at the annulus, which we used with the help of a cardiac MRI, but you can use a 2D echocardiogram also, and a balloon to annulus ratio 1.2 to 1.4. Smaller balloons have a higher chance of restenosis, and larger balloons, if you use larger balloons, you have a higher chance of RV artery injury and pulmonary regurgitation. It's a pretty safe procedure. Mortality is 0.24%. Major complication rate is 0.35%. The main thing you have to watch out for is post-pulmonary valvoplasty infundibular obstruction, in which case this can be treated with beta blockers and generally esmolol drip. Complete heart blocks, rupture of tricuspid valve, papillary muscle is another complication. There can be pulmonary artery tear, and also long-term you have to watch out for pulmonary valve regurgitation in these cases. In a long-term follow-up, the severe pulmonary regurgitation occurred only in 7% of cases at 7 years, and the restenosis rate at 15 years was found to be about 20% in a long-term follow-up. This patient has followed up with us for 2 years now, a rapid improvement in symptoms, and a follow-up echo so far has not revealed any significant worsening of pulmonary valve gradients or development of severe pulmonary regurgitation. Thank you.
Thank you, Abdesh. Questions for him?
Abdesh, is balloon, I've never done this, is balloon slippage a issue? Because I've seen in India when I was young that people would put a catheter in the ascending aorta and inject to locate exactly where, how to center the balloon, and they would then track the indentation of the balloon to properly dilate this. Because sometimes, and I asked them, my senior residents, why, and they would say, we want to position it perfectly, mm-hmm. because there can be balloon slippage. Mm-hmm. So in this case, I did not see a waste of the balloon.
Right.
There was one. So there was a little bit?
Yes. So
very subtle.
So what I did was...
subtle waste.
Yes,
that's enough.
Exactly. Okay. So what we did was that we actually did an RV gram. If you see this image, we did an RV gram after the balloon is in, because the anatomy can change.
Yes.
Once you have a stiff wire across it. So before going up on the balloon, I did an RV gram. And the second thing where you prevent slippage is by doing the rapid pacing.
Okay.
So that's why, you know, you can, in the next slide, you can see we did rapid pacing, you almost achieve cardiac standstill, and then you can go up nicely on that. Because slippage is very, very important. You don't want to injure the pulmonary artery.
Excellent.
Mario? Just two quick questions. First of all, do you need to know the coronary anatomy before you do this? And number two, what is the recurrence rate, actually? When do you expect her to have another intervention?
You do not need to know coronary anatomy. She's only 25. There was no reason to suspect coronary artery disease in her. The restenosis rate, there was a large study about follow-up about a few hundred patients. What they looked at her was re-intervention rate. At 15 years, 77% of patients were without any re-intervention at 15 years. So it's a pretty good, treatment for, and the treatment of choice. For pulmonary valve stenosis. And then re-ballooning at that time is the treatment of choice.
Certainly, if you're putting in a stent, you'd want to know the coronary anatomy.
Yes.
Because of the risk of compression.
Yes.
Yeah. Very good.
Thank you.